copy, shift box.
Okay, radio check.
Yeah, radio is working fine.
Yeah, copy on personnel.
Yeah, copy, mate.
That's it, we're ready to go. Right, I'm in bloody true air leg of spirit here. I've got the bloody, he's bought me a King Brown. I'm even having a dart. Well, no, first darts on television.
Well, all my uncles were air leggers. They, man,
I still sort of quit, so it's like, whatever.
At the end of the day, you'd always see him, you know, King Brown, pack of, you know, Capstan friggin' tins. Bloody,
I think tins, is that the tins that had the tobacco on that?
Yeah.
I better drink this before she gets warm.
You want to hold out? I don't think I've got a stubby cool to fit, mate. I piss in.
Have a look at the size of the bloody thing.
Oi.
Thanks for having me up in a bloody thriving Gerro, mate. This is my first time in Gerro.
Really?
It took you to get me up here.
Oh, you're mad. You're bloody mad. Eh? You've come all the way to visit bloody mate.
Yeah, how good is it? Oh, no. As I said to the missus, she's like, well, what are you doing after the interview? I said, oh, I'm having a roast and having a drink. She's bloody
duck,
holiday.
Duck across the pub, bloody, I'll take, drag the boat out, mate, go and catch a couple of bloody jewies or something. Hey,
not the point to me. I'm coughing my guts up after this.
No gay smoking. Put it out if you don't
want. This is a legitimate cigarette, trust me. It's not an old school, not a proper air legger cigarette. It's got a filter in it.
I only ever had that happen once, eh? That was with a guy called... Chris Bargy.
Oh, what a mistake in the ingredients.
No, they used to get around with a bloody half a pouch of tobacco, half a pouch of bloody Marlin. Working with him there and asked him for a smoke and he rolled one up and, yeah, sure enough, like, sat me on my ass, he just propped me up in the corner. You stay there, young fella.
Was this underground?
It was underground. Only ever happened twice.
Oh, how good's that? Yeah. Right, so we better go back to the – we'll just go back to the start. We'll do what I did with Mickey Ratt. Bloody, each mine site's got its own bloody story.
Usually
highlight story. Yeah. I'm sure it's got some have got bloody more than others. But
I'd like to start with my poem, Matt. To all my mates out there.
Oh, is that the one give me?
Yeah. Miners, mothers, and mean motherfuckers. They could muck for two miners and mine for two muckers. They were mean motherfuckers, eh? Collar a hole on a doorknob, bore a lifter in a sack of marbles, even timber dirty water if they had to. They were mean mother truckers. Yeah, and it does go on, but I can't remember the rest of it off the top of my head. And then there's dark as a dungeon, damp as the dew, where the dangers are doubled and the pleasures are few. Greg Smith told me those at Concurry. He's an old tin miner.
Oh, yeah.
Shaft sinking.
We'll have to write them down.
Yeah, easy enough to remember those ones. There isn't too many mining poems in the industry, are you? You don't hear of too many.
No, you don't, do you?
Not really. There's a lot of sad ones or, you know, songs and ballads, you know, places fall in and all that kind of shit, Big John. And Actually, Mickey Nolan is a guy you'd want to pay tribute to. He actually, he wrote a song. He's an airlegger, gimpy airleg miner.
Yeah.
I was down in Woods Point with him and, he's got one on YouTube called The Silver Lady. We should play it a bit later.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Oh, there you go. Well, speaking of stuff to play, I have got... before we this would be a good segue to
what's a segue?
I don't know, it's just you know those words you don't know the meaning of, but that you know they're the right time to use it.
Okay.
It's one of them.
Like segue.
See, something like that.
Well, like salubrious.
I actually did get someone sent a question in to you. There is a few questions to go through, but here was one.
Ask Eric. The timer working to burn a car and he snatched it, decided to grab his shit and walk to wherever, didn't get picked up, walk for ages, killed his feet, had to get a police report put out looking for him. It was quite impressive.
That's
Tucker.
Courtesy of David Tucker, Media Centre.
It was stupid bloody, it wasn't stupid, like if I ever had money or time, well, you need time and money and all that kind of stuff. I think I could walk across Australia, like follow the old prospect and paths or whatever. But
like Forrest Gump.
Not Forrest Gump, mate, just a nice steady trip across the Oz looking for minerals and gold and all that. But, yeah, that was a pretty stupid move on my behalf. What happened? Okay, so I'd bored into Bunakara, was all broken close to the surface, sort of dirt.
And up Meekatharra way, isn't it?
Yeah, between Meekatharra and Kew.
Yep.
And Yeah, so I bought out this cut and it was just muddy, gravelly, sand kind of thing. Like it was only three cuts and breakthrough. Anyway, so bought out a cut, charged her up, let her go, come back down and like just frozen. But there was ampho in the face, tails, and you know, like when you rise, you have no real option, but it was a second cut up actually. And there was only three cuts breakthrough. So I ran a 10-footer up, broke through. You're not supposed to bore in the face with bloody, you know, misfires or, you know, frozen face, all that kind of stuff. Sometimes you don't have any choice. And sure enough, got a breakthrough straight up about 2 meters. So there should have been a meter of a 3 meter steel sticking out somewhere. But I could not find this breakthrough. Otherwise, it would have been bored out and let go, you know, like as you do. And so I searched the level above, searched drive, couldn't find this bloody breakthrough of this rise. So anyway, I wasn't too popular up there. There was a lot of strong miners. I'd just come in, you know, new guy, rah-rah, breaking good dirt, you know, like people think you're there to take the job or whatever. And anyway, so I was like, shit. So I think it was on afternoon shift. So, yeah, I was on afternoon shift. So I reported it to my engine. I said, well, look, I've got a cut down there. It's frozen up. Put a breakthrough steel up, couldn't find the bloody breakthrough, and I haven't fired it because I don't know where the breakthrough is. I need survey to go down there, pick it up, find out where this bloody breakthrough is. Anyway, shift boss on day shift, he didn't go too much on me. And so sure enough, he's gone stuck his head up there, and I chopped everything off the best I could, dug it out with screwdrivers, cleaned it up, made sure, you know, there was no capture or anything like that, and they all checked all the end of my non-Ls and whatever, and there was no explosives there, and everything had gone off and just frozen. And so I said, look, yeah, Stewie, he goes, you're going to be dismissed, mate, eh? Like, rah. I was like, but can you go down and finish the cut?
Of course. Well,
of course, yeah.
No one else would want to go and finish that one.
No, it's got explosives. They're going to get sacked too. Rah. And he said, this is where your breakthrough is. It was actually, you know, come through on a windrow and there's a big pile of buddy dirt there, and yeah, just couldn't see it. I listened for it, couldn't hear it, couldn't see it. Anyway, so I was like, no worries at all. Anyway, you know, it's 3:30 in the afternoon, 4 o'clock in the afternoon. I was like, so then I thought, I'm not going to go and boy, this cut out and be dismissed in the bloody morning. I was like, stuff, you crack the shits as I do, you know, like get a bit hot headed sometimes. So I said to the boys, stuff this, I'm going, eh? It's like, hey, where are you going? I said, home. Packed up your bag, didn't have much, grabbed a bloody couple of 1 litre water bottles, a bit of fruit, a couple of sandwiches, hit the frog and toad. Like it's about 40 or 50K out to the main road. Got to lift out.
Yeah,
30, 40K anyway. And then we got to the road and thought, oh, you know, just grab a lift. But of course, you know, 7, 8 o'clock at night.
I'll say you walked 40Ks.
I walked close to 95K. I got picked up about 10Ks outside of Kew. By some roaming judge some judge that was going from one town to the next.
Yeah.
Jumped in with me, but then I had to report. There was a report out for me to.
Missing person report.
Missing person. Oh, not missing person. I actually had wrote a note to the mine manager. I can't think of his name, but yeah, and told him what I was doing. threw it on his desk. And yeah, so walked off. Actually, it was the stupidest but best thing that ever happened to me. Because that was the night that the next day I actually met Marlene again after 20 years of being apart.
Yeah.
So I walked off this mine site, blistered my feet, reported to the police, bloody A, give a truck driver $100 to drive me to Perth. Jumped on a bloody, so I got to Perth, jumped on a train, headed straight into the city because I was heading out to Fremantle, my brother's place, but stopped into a bar to have a bloody beer. And we miss Marlene sitting at the bar. She's still got her wedding rings on and still got my same last name. So we just started chatting on about, you know, 20 years gone by or where we'd been for 20 years. Rah, rah, rah. Crazy night. Bar shut. We both just said, send this bar a bit. But, we went back to her place and we said, oh, you know, stay here. This is only going to lead to trouble. And she goes, I don't mind a bit of trouble. So,
And here we are today.
Yeah, 3 weeks later, I was in bloody Italy with us. So good shocking story, but good story. Yeah, so
well, there you go.
Like most of my stories always end up with a pretty good ending. blessed with good fortune, I am.
There you bloody go.
So I haven't got too many stories about Bernie Carroll. That's about the only one, and that's a pretty mild one for my stories, eh?
Oh, we can bloody oh, you can increase the intensity as we go along.
Oh, not so much. It was intense to start with. So my first mining job, well, funnily enough, I'd always been mining. Like my stepfather, he had a small show out at Orabanda that I'm sure he only started just to keep us kids out of town. How we used to have to hand, we mined with an electric kanga, fracture or dynamite, and bloody me and my brother used to hand windlass the dirt to the surface.
Yeah.
And then after school,
is that just north of Cairn?
Yeah, Broad Arrow, Orabanda area, Mount Better Station. We had a small mine out there, and I was the best fun. I used to spend every weekend out there.
Yeah.
Quite sad when the grandfather died out there. But then after school later on, because I knew a little bit, how to shovel dirt anyway. You don't take much to shovel dirt. I used to actually work for an old prospector that had a small mine behind Bunnings, and I used to shovel all his dirt about three times for him. He used to take, 44, like most of us take 44 a week into dirt. So
yeah,
he'd shovel a 44 of dirt. And then I was an apprentice in the mines, KMA, KLV. And that's where I met the first Peters, like Chaffers Shaft. Well, so we used to look after, as an apprentice in the mines, we looked after Lakeview, Perseverance, Chaffers. Didn't have too much to do with Mount Charlotte. Used to go down there occasionally, but we weren't allowed underground until we'd completed our second year. So third year, we actually got to get dated down the hole. And that's where I met Peter Moore, who ended up, kicked me in the arse. And, yeah, so I have a lot of Peters in my life that...
What year was this? When was this?
That would have been 1988, 89, 88.
Yeah.
Because 89 I was cutting the Blair portal. And so I was tend to go back to where we were, and I remember cutting all the letters out back to front on that Blair portal to Blair 1989, stuff that up there as first job as I come out of my apprenticeship.
Yeah.
But there was another job before that I actually deferred in my third year, or starting my fourth, I deferred my apprenticeship to go over to Concurry, Queensland. Now, that's the craziest story that, and the great one of the greatest adventures I'd ever been on, eh? Yeah, we left. Never been outside of, Kalgoorlie, Geraldton and Perth was as far as I'd ever gone, or Kalgoorlie, Leonora, Geraldton and Perth. And Ray Keane and Jeff Donaldson had a small mining company called Integra Mining, and the bloke that went over, the miner that went over them with them, he got bashed by the locals got into a dolly, and they put him in hospital over there for misbehaving in town or something. I don't know the full story, so I won't go there. But they asked me if I'd go over there and drive the air winch for them, because they knew what I could do and what I couldn't. So that was crazy, eh?
So you're about 20 years old?
No, not even. I think I was about 19.
19, yeah.
Yeah, 19, I guess. Because I was still in my apprenticeship, 18, 19. And, I'd been married, so yeah, 19. You got the big brown suitcase, your luggage, first time out, Perth Airport, Brisbane. They didn't know where the hell I was going. It was just all amazing. So then I had to catch a plane from Brisbane to Mount Isa, and I had to make my way, get on a bus from Mount Isa to Concurry. But the whole thing was a disaster because I landed in Mount Isa and a couple of birds had hit the plane on the way over, and we couldn't open the door, and it was about 50 degrees on the tarmac. I was just amazed. Everything in Queensland's a big A. It's just especially when you're 18, never been anywhere. So I got off the plane and went into a pub there looking to where to catch the bus from, or caught a taxi. They were supposed to meet me there, I think, but it all got muddled up and I had to get on a bus to get out to Concurry. Walked into a pub, and over there the pubs were still segregated. There was a blacks pub and a whites pub. And I walked straight to the blacks pub, more my style. Bloody, there and there with 10-gallon heads, and the Aboriginals over there, nothing compared to ones in West Australia. They're all, really big men, Anyway, so I walked in there, realised where I was, and went to walk out again. And aren't we good enough to drink with? I was give me a midi. Right there, and then, was catching a bus that afternoon. So got out to, it actually must have been the next morning because, had a bit of a wild night. I think I might have slept in the creek there somewhere. Got on a bus the next morning here at Concurry, and it's only an hour and a half up the road. And had to go to the post office hotel, or one of the hotels there anyway. So I walked in there with my big brown suitcase on those stupid bloody vinyl suitcases. And, so I'm sitting there having a beer, waiting. I might have been having a squash, probably, and waiting for Ray Keane or someone to come and grab me. Anyway, these three really big girls come in there, Marianne Lawrence was the name, or Marianne Lawrence, something like that. And they sit this little nook corner area, and they sit right in front of it. They go, hey, hello, bloke. G'day.
Like, where are you from? I said, oh, Kalgoorlie. What are you doing over here? I said, oh, come over and do a bit of mining at this Gilded Rose with Ray. Ah, what do you want to do that for? I said, oh, it's just a job. Hey, we have a thing over here called question time. I was like, what? Yeah, no, we've got to ask you a question. You've got to answer them. Honestly, hey, otherwise bad things could happen to you. I was like, holy shit, man, what's going on here? Anyway, she reckons, hey, so names, what's your name? I reckon, oh, Eric. She reckons, and you're from Kalgoorlie? I reckon, yeah, it's shit old, she reckons. And she reckons, oh, what'd she ask you? She goes, you ever sniff your sister's undies? I was like, fuck, what? She goes, yeah, you look like one of those blokes, eh? You look like one of those. I was like, no, I've never done nothing like that, eh? Anyway, she lifts the skirt up and she goes, would you get into a bit of this? I was like, oh, you know, she's got these big bloomers on. Like, yeah, I said, no, hey, I got to go. She reckons, you're going nowhere, right? Sit down there. You're staying right where you are. I was like, no, I've got to meet some blokes. She reckons, stay where you are. You're not going anywhere. And I said, no, excuse me. I'm trying to squeeze past them. Sit down, they reckon. Yeah, it was pretty scary. And even after that, it didn't end there. So they finally let me know that I was coming with them, and they got this tiny, you know, those little yellow Hiluxes that you used to get. Of course, three big girls, and I'm on a mattress in the back with a 44-gallon drum of diesel. This is without exaggeration, man. I say, like, nine years of age, like three big girls, well, wild girls. They weren't just like big girls. They were just mad, these girls. They were like funny, but yeah, crazy. So I'd throw my suitcase in the back of the ute, and we're heading out to this place called Gilded Rose, just outside of Concurry. Anyway, halfway along there, like, I start smelling this smoke and feeling a bit of heat in the mattress. So lifted the mattress, and this mattress is just going boom, up in flames. Hey, it's like, holy shit. So I'm climbing over the roof of the car, banging on the roof, and like, well, you know, back's on fire, and threw the mattress out, and because there's diesel everywhere in the back of the ute, the bloody back of the ute, and so it's smothering. I lost my eyebrows and bloody dashing. It was the craziest adventure I'd ever been on. And even then, it didn't stop there. So, and this is my first mining job ever outside of Kalgoorlie. So we're there for about a month or two, and sinking, like, because I'm a timberman, carpenter, you know, we're sinking this shaft down, advancing our 1.2 a day, or, you know, 1.5 a day, horrible hard country, and in copper, chasing, doing a bog sample with an ore lifter. But anyway, so, yeah, it's definitely 1989, 1988, because there's actually a plaque on the bridge over there. So I'm sitting there as a hoist driver, and I see the whole horizon just turning brown. I mean, like, you see it on postcards and all that kind of stuff, but, you know, like, there's goannas and kangaroos and emus going past the little shaft that we're doing, and I was like, what the hell's going on in here? And this brown cloud's just getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And, yeah, it was a rainstorm hit. So a couple of days before, it was 54.7 degrees in the shade sitting out there under this bloody tarp driving this hoist. And, yeah, then this meter of rain hit. Like, yeah, and we got the boys out of the shaft. And, Ray and Les Frechet was his name. And we're running up to the bloody dongers, and next minute our dongers are floating around. And
Shit.
Yeah, but it was all – we ended up in Townsville for the – they ended up flying us out, or helicoptering us out, and trying to get Marianne on this helicopter. And it was just like crazy, eh? It was just like,
oh, so where'd you, when they took you on the little joyride, how did you then – when was the point where you got picked up to go to work?
She was a camp cook.
They
actually took us to work, Matt. Yeah, so they took me out to the mine. But
you got abducted there for a minute. Well, you sort of did.
Well, it was like being abducted, eh? They were pretty bloody, they were pretty wild women, eh? She ended up going to jail. I don't know the truth of this, so I shouldn't say too much, but I did hear when we went back later on to the Ernest Henry shaft sink, and that she had actually gone to jail for cutting, you know, I'm not 100% sure, but. Yeah, hurting somebody, done a few years jail. Yeah, she was mad, eh? Oh. Like, good fun, great fun, local girl.
Jeez, there you go. It's bloody hard living over, like, North Queensland. They're bloody tough pricks over there.
They are, mate. They're the toughest breed in the country. Like, Tasmanians are the toughest miners. Like, anyone that can work out minus 10 and walk across that continent, they're definitely tough. But the Queensland, as far North Queensland men, the cowboys, ringers and all that kind of stuff, they're just fair dinkum. They just hard. God, yeah, just hard. You know, like anyone that wrestles bulls and all that kind of stuff, they know how to handle themselves.
Right? Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I've got touched up quite a few times. Yeah.
Who's all talking to? You know, air legger Bob Anderson?
Yeah, well, really, yeah, one of the best mates, yeah.
Big boy, yeah. He was up at Paulson's. He said, he says, I've been in some blues, but when I worked in North Queensland, them ringers and that, they'll never met people that can punch so hard.
Like, oh,
just tough as anything, he reckons. He could take a couple of punches too.
Oh, shit, he wouldn't hurt Bob, ain't he? Well, funnily enough, I lived with Bob in Charters Towers, and he picked me up off the street a couple of times, and I like dollied up and was like, silly back.
Oh, because you wouldn't be able to shut your mouth either, would you?
You didn't even have to open your mouth over there, right? If you were sitting at a bar and someone looked across and you even glanced, and usually small, tiny blokes, they just love to punch on, man. Like, you didn't have to have a reason. It's not like West Australia where you're either playing pool or chatting up someone's messes.
Yeah.
Over there, it was just like, look the wrong way or have the wrong clothes on or something like that. She's on, you know? Yeah, like, no shit, man. It was that Charters Tower. This is probably one of the toughest places I've seen, like, just for full-on punch-ups, like, just maniac, just... Yeah. You know, blow for blow, and they don't stop it. They go for hours, and they'll get up and have a beer with you or whatever. It's just like good fun for them, eh?
That's half of them come in just to their release.
It is, been out in the station for a month, or been out, rousing or whatever it is for a month or two.
Come out bloody 30 schooners and a few fights, and good
pick
weekend.
Up, yeah, pick up bloody shield if they can. That's the guy I got in trouble. I usually take them off before they got there. Good night, love.
Well, how long did you live up in, do around the North Queensland area?
I've done most of my mining in Queensland, Matt. So I've done a lot over here. So I've done my apprenticeship in Blair, Mount Edwards, Wanaway, but most of my Queensland was Charters Towers, Concurry, Mount Isa, Gympie, done a lot of years in Gympie, and then up and down the East Coast, I've mined. Yeah, everywhere down the East Coast, Victoria, bloody New South, all that kind of stuff. So always for a contractor at Ryzen, something like that.
So what was your pathway onto the air leg? When did you get on the air leg after your little joyride at your first gig?
Yeah, so my first gig, I come back and I actually worked for Dave Moroney doing my mining. He was a Frenchman, and I was actually, because I come back to finish my apprenticeship after Concurry, and I was just like shaft sinking, just driving a hoist and getting explosives down and all that. Come back and... done a bit of work on Dave Moroney's house, and he was doing my mining, French bloke, tied up with Ashok and all that. And they got the contract to cut the portal at Blair Nickel Mine. So done a bit of work on his house, and he said, I told him I was a former carpenter and all that.
Where's Blair Nickel Mine again?
Between Cambolda and Kalgoorlie, heading out towards Mount Munger Way. So out the 45, one of those roads out there.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, went out there, met some fantastic guys out there, Blas, Joey Thumlet, and a couple of good guys. And that was the first time I'd actually even picked up a machine. So all my mining beforehand was electric Kangaroo or, shaft sinking. I was only driving a hoist there. So went out there and we cut the portal handheld, and I'd done all the formwork, steel sets and all that. And down to the first first ventilation rise, and then out to Cambolda, Foster Shaft. Where you actually learned to be organised, and we used to keep all the maintenance on Foster Shaft, and Mount Edwards went away, just small portals, like small jobs, working for Dave. Anyway, then my father died or whatever, and I had a few months off, and that's when I went up to Bellevue with actually Anstra Mining. That was Gary Mays's mining company at Bellevue's. He was working for Burncut, like manager or something. I'm not sure how it worked. But I went up there as a hoist driver, driving a gig rise for Jamie Duff, Byron Parker, Mickey Fitzgerald, and myself. And they were doing small internal winds from the shaft to the decline, I think it was. And, and going to and from that shaft one day was my first fatality underground. Kenny Buller he was in a stope just up from us. And we went up for lunch and come back, and we got a wave that he was actually squashed under a big rock about half size his table, actually. And we lifted the rock and we dragged him out from underneath him. And then after that, they'd finished the rise, and I asked Maisie, I asked Gary, I was like, Gary, any chance of going rise mining? And I think he choked, they laughed. And I said, look, if I can't get him cut a shift, I'll hop on a truck and I'll never ever ask again. And yeah, give me a crack. It was, I think I got to spend two or three shifts with a bloke called Dave Monahan, champion bloke, good bloke. And then I was on my own. So yeah, I had a 40 metre basalt rise and I'd never really picked up a machine before. So
it's hard. So this build just hard as fuck.
Yeah. Man, it wasn't hard. Well, it was hard. It was really, as I learned later, it was really, really hard ground, but I didn't know any different or any better. All I know was that, yeah, I sat down the bottom of that rise and cried a couple of times. Eh? It was just like, yeah. You used to have these two pegs, you mark up your face and had everyone giving me advice, you know, like do this and do that and check this out and how you had ladders. And I had, you know, gone up there with Dave. So, yeah, but anyway, she was a battle. But I got through it. But I used to be first down the hole, last to leave. And, yeah, finally. But even then, it still took me, I reckon, at least 6 or 7 years before I was confident enough to say that I could drop two or three cuts a shift. You know, yeah. Like, yeah, it was a hard going. Yeah.
How long did you do out of Bellevue?
A bit over. We would have been close to 18 months. Elton's took over the contract from us. But, that was crazy. Bellevue was mad, man. And it was my introduction to mining because like what I had earned previously as an apprentice carpenter with my wife and, you know, like living the, you know, like living the apprenticeship life in Kalgoorlie, married, you know, like $300, $420 a week, whatever. I went up to Bellevue and once I'd done those rises and all that, they put me with a stope miner and basically I was getting 50% of a miner's rate, you know, like half his rate was my job to a trainee miner. And yeah, I was earning that a day, you know, like $350 to $420 a day in the hand. It was like, oh my God.
Yeah, which is what, like early 1990s? Like, yeah, it was, Commodore would have been, what, 20 grand or something?
Oh,
like,
yeah, but we didn't even get to look at that. It was just like, just piss and party. It was just like, holy shit. Yeah, because I'd left my wife by then and we'd gone our separate ways, kind of. And, yeah, so our weekend, so we used to work 8-hour shifts and, yeah, so there was plenty of time for drinking and every third weekend we would be on some crazy adventure down to Kalgoorlie or Thursday afternoon or knock off Friday morning to drive across to Perth, you know, from Bellevue, which is a straight, you know, 10-hour drive, but we'd get there, you know, 10 o'clock at night straight into the clubs.
And oh, Jesus Christ, funnily enough,
I had never, ever been into a big night, you know, nightclub either, you know, like it was crazy. So that's where I met Peter McPhillamy, or Macca, or brother Mac. He, so we drove down from Bellevue with Richard Babick in Victoria and here we're going straight to these bloody nightclubs and took my first pill that I'd ever bloody had and it was just ridiculous. It was just like, oh my God.
Oh, that's Macca Macca.
Yeah.
So he reckons he still says, I'll give him his first bloody trip or something. He's never been the same since.
Oh, I was never the same, Matty. Yeah, it was like, it was.
He wasn't working with you. You met him in Perth.
No, he was working with us up there. He actually had the coffee shop in Leinster then, but then he came out to work at Bellevue with us. Yeah, so it must have happened all about the same time because I remember meeting him at the coffee shop once and then we were all out to Bellevue and the blokes out of Bellevue were just brilliant. Eh? It was like little Tasmania, all the Tasmanians over there and, tough, hard boys, eh? Everyone was into it. A couple of sad stories out there, you know, like other than Kenny Buller, that was terrible. It was actually shocking, but... Dots, he was an old miner. He come unstuck out. He didn't die. He ended up blowing a blood vessel. And but in between all that, it was just a great, great community, eh? Like, so the best party I'd ever been to, and still to this day, probably one of the best parties I'd ever been to was Julie and Mick Packham had brought the Sandstone Pub. And they sent an invite out to every mine within Coowee of Sandstone. So, you know, Magnet Boys across there and Bellevue, a few from Leinster. And, you know, we're basically, they come from everywhere, man. Eh? And that pub and whole street was that jam-packed, eh? Like Mick had brought bloody skimpies up from over there, drugs from the coast, bloody, I was mad, live band, eh? And you couldn't get into the pub. I think they ran out of beer pretty early and they had to duck at someone. A couple of boys jumped in the utes to duck across the Magnet to go and get more bloody piss because we're drunk and pug and cry, eh? Yeah, no, I was mad, eh? It was great. But even those people, like, Julie and Mick. You know, Julie used to walk around that camp and make crayfish pizzas, you know, like, so, you know, there's like a caravan park there when communities, you know, it's like a little community, you know, like people lived up there with their kids and all that kind of stuff. And, you know, so they used to bring, you know, crayfish pizzas around to the bloody boys and, you know, dongers. And, you know, there's always a barbecue or live music up there. Like it was, I remember when I first got up there, all the, there's not many boys dance, you know, blokes dance and all that kind of stuff. And I was always pretty out there. Not that I knew how to dance and all that, but, I remember all the Bernie girls and all their husbands, I reckon. I get out on the dance floor and shake them up a little bit. And yeah, a real man. Come here, you and mine. They were mad, eh?
You're lucky you didn't do it in North. Well, that's what you're doing in North Queensland too, yeah. Didn't you?
Oh, no, not too much. But Gary, I head off to Gary Mays. He gave me my start. I'm grateful for it. Like, and he was a hard, tough boss. You know, he didn't. The only time you spoke to him is if you're in the shit. You didn't really, you know, didn't really have to communicate with foremans and managers. You basically just went down, done your job, yeah, and come up. And yeah, if you didn't hear from him, you were going all right.
Yeah, yeah.
And if you're talking to him, you're in the shit.
Because he's down Tassie, eh? Or he's on the to-do list. I think Ross Graham said, buddy, try and track him down because he'd be another good one to.
I got his number there, mate. I rang him actually only about 3-4 weeks ago.
Yeah.
After 10 or 12 years to see how he's going. And yeah, he's going great. He's looking after. A show, I think, I'm sure he said Mount Lyle. I don't know. But I'll give you his number before we finish up.
Yeah.
Yeah. A lot of great men. And then from there, from Bellevue, I went over to Stan Gilman. And what a gentleman. Stan is, gave me a start. Him and his brothers, Greg and Mark, fantastic men. Yeah, like really, really solid blokes.
So that was Southern Cross?
Southern Cross, yeah. Yeah.
So was that was Golden Pig, was it?
No, it was Transvaal.
Yeah.
Yeah. So they didn't have the Golden Pig there. Golden Pig was still run by whoever. I'm not sure who it was. But Stan had Transvaal, and a lot of good blokes in there, mate. Eh? Like, Dean Fruin and Michael Briggs. Strong airleggers, Jeff Coops. But yeah, that's a funny story there. So you ever met Justin Leader? He's a wine foreman, fantastic jumbo operator. Good air league, mate. Basically just a great all-rounder anyway.
Is that so that Jeff Coops you're talking about? Is that Jeffrey Cooper on the he's still on the jumbo now? Yeah, mate. Selby was cross-shifting him. Yeah, he's still going.
Yeah, great air leaguer too, eh? Yeah. Solid, strong air league.
Yeah, right.
Great, better jumbo operator, they told me. He's down at Nova, I think, last time I seen Jeff. But
he's at that bloody Garden Well, that bloody, Rosemont. Yeah, he was at Nova with him. Yeah.
No, great bloke. He actually lived next door to a good mate of mine, but that was another sad story. But John, Justin Leader, so I was always a bit of a cheeky prick, you know, like always been the same, always silly, open my mouth before I think.
Oh, wouldn't be you, Eric.
No. Anyway, Justin had an ass on him about not quite the size of this table, probably 3/4, but he was built all over, just a big, big bloke. Eh? And remember the debts we used to get with those big, thick lackey bands on them?
So we used to
have these big bloody, half inch bloody lackey bands on, mate. Yeah. Anyway,
flick them in the showers at each other. Yeah.
Oh, shit, yeah. Well, anyway, that's exactly what I've done, Matt. So Justin's walked past with his big fat ass, and I'll just pull this lackey band back and give it to him. Fair square on the ass cheek, eh? He just turned around, threw his towel over me, and he just knocked me out cold. I'm just like,
what, in the showers?
In the showers, in the stark naked, mate. Yeah, like. Yeah, but it was many a good story like that out of Southern Cross. Eh? It's like there's always trouble. End up in court a couple of times there for chatting to the bloody chatting to the wrong man's bloody girlfriend or something like that.
Do tell.
No, it wasn't. There wasn't too much, and you sort of like Shane because obviously Shane Little and all those local boys and all that kind of stuff. They're all the footballers, So and of course they're all just learning mining farmers and all that kind of stuff, and a bunch of us. Air leggers come through and all of a sudden, we were enemies for a while until they started employing, Frankie King and Shane Little and all those boys out of there. Wayne Benelli, all Benelli boys, they were all local mad buggers too, Not as mad as the far north Queenslands, but they all liked to party on too and didn't like us chatting to their girls. So No, it was crazy time, Southern Cross. But I was actually glad, I was really glad to get out of there because it started to get sad in the end because that's when a lot of drugs and all that kind of started coming into the industry, and we had a couple of terrible incidents there with one of our good mates there had a handgun, and somehow his partner got shot. Don't know how, when, or wouldn't want to speculate on it. And then one of the apprentices from work, he actually murdered a young girl there, which is actually terrible. Could have been, if you had you know, like this day and age, how we have all our support and all that kind of stuff. Well, there wasn't too much of that there. And then, you know, the answer was, I'll take him behind the shed and flog him, you know, like someone had to take him by the hand maybe, or showed him, you know, like, you know, where he was going wrong, or, you know, it wouldn't have happened. Someone's life could have been saved, or, yeah, a few instances underground, but not too many. It was, it was good. And it was great times, you know, like Stan was a good boss. Yeah, hated departing money. I never paid as much. And being honest, I didn't earn much. I've never been the strongest miner, Matt. I've always been neat and looked after myself, and I haven't had too many accidents over in my career. So, but yeah, I probably got exactly what I earned, because some of the boys earned good money, but I was always that. It was funny coming through, you know, you get your 240 for your, what was the rates used to be, about 180 a meter. So, you know, once you hit that 360 or whatever, you're going all right. And I don't think I've ever got as high as 420 or 450 working for Stan, eh? I'd always damage something or break something off. And come and go. They used to call me far lap there. I think I had about 5 or 6 starts with Stan over the years. No, great days, eh? Good men.
How long did you live at Southern Cross?
Off and on, it would have been, I reckon, 3 years. But it was over a period of time. I left Southern Cross and went over to Far North Queensland, Ravenswood.
Yeah.
And that was a great, great job, fantastic job. That's where I bumped into Tony Mehole again, and the first time since I was a child. I knew Tony as a, funny enough, when we were living in Leonora's kids, they all used to work up on Insta on the shaft, and they used to call in and say good to him. We used to take his car, a big red Jaguar, to the drive-ins, the old Leonora drive-ins and all that kind of stuff. So I went over to Ravenswood, Queensland, and, you know, Shane Vincenzoni, all those guys, Jerry Van Dyke, you know, good funny men, eh? Like, that was a crazy invention. I bumped into Bobby Anderson over there again, and, great fun times. Ravenswood, not too much. Oh, actually, there was a couple of great stories in Ravenswood, because our weekends were spent in Townsville, you know. surviving the AJs and the local, if you weren't getting in a scrap in town with the bloody local ringers. Ravenswood didn't have too many, actually. That was probably more Charters Towers, but Ravenswood every weekend, Brett Law, all those boys, we all used to, Milton, Big Calve, they'd jump on their Harleys, and we'd all head into Townsville for the weekend, and, you know, the drags, you know, drags would be on. There was always something happening in Townsville, eh?
Yeah,
and then you always had the army blokes in town and all that kind of stuff, so... Yeah, you didn't take too much to get into a bit of trouble with those blokes. So, remember one night there, I was like in this pub, and I was with this young girl, and one of them had grabbed her on the butt or something like that. So I just leant over and cracked this guy. Hey, it's just like straight up. I was like, I'm not mucking around. There's 6 of them. I was just like straight into it, straight at it. Boom, all these arms just coming at me. I was just like, I'm off, eh? And staying over near the town, the casino. Might have been staying at the casino for British Miners. We probably were. And on the way to the casino, there's this little bowls club on the left-hand side anyway. So these guys are half a block behind me. I've got a bit of a head start. I'm like, jumped over the hedge, and it's like they'd gone past anyway. So thought, I'm not sticking me out, because those guys are everywhere, and yeah, they know the local scene. So just snuck out a couple of louvers out of the bowls club, and I jumped into the bowls club and just crashed for the night. You know, when I was climbing out in the morning, of course, there was a copper in the car park, and I explained my circumstance, and turned this deal, I would have hit him too.
I'll give you a lift.
Yeah, let me go. Yeah, rang up the boys. Yeah. No, great days.
Have you had many? I think I remember a few stories you ripped out at the pub. You had a couple of sleepovers at the police stations in your time, haven't you? Oh, not sleepovers, temporary.
Yeah, temporary. Like, I mean, so yeah, it's back to Southern Cross. We what's the Diamond Driller? It was always a bit of a running with Diamond Drillers. I was doing something stupid in the pub. Like, you don't get hit unless you deserve it most of the times, eh? And I was hanging off some rafters and might have kicked someone's beer over there. And anyway, this Diamond Driller come up and cracked me, and we ended up in between the two Rally Seeger cars. And yeah, of course, coppers come in, dragged us out, locked us up for the night. The only other time was we finished a job in Mount Isa with Chris Groves, who was an absolute fantastic bloke, eh? And someone had dropped a Mickey on me, and I sold a couple of coppers, and that was a bad night. Yeah, I thought I was going to jail for sure, but I had no recollection of the events. It was like, walked into a pub, had 2 beers. It was the night the World Cup, Australia played France, I think it was, in the World Cup year 2000, 2001, something like that. And yeah, Fun of Hogs Best Cafe. And funny enough, they had video footage of it. So I got away with it. Like I was.
What, of them dropping the Mickey in your drink?
No, not that part. So I was feeling like I had me two beers or something. I was feeling a bit dizzy. So I thought I'll go out and get some fresh air. And I sat down and I basically fell asleep on the lawn in front of Hogs Best Cafe. And this copper came along and he stood on me head to wake me up, you know, just shook me forward to wake me up. And I had like no recollection. So I elbowed him in the knee and the female copper grabbed me around the neck and elbowed her and opened up her brow. And of course, yeah, like, it was pretty severe. It was like the duty lawyer in the morning said that I'd be doing jail time for assaulting a public officer. It's like, oh, that is what it is, tell me, brother. Anyway, then we walk down the street, and funny enough, how things work out. Like I said, I'm blessed with good fortune sometimes. Because the spoke said, how'd you get on? And I was like, oh, it looks like I'm, you know, in the shit, you know, pay some big fines and might be doing some time. And he goes, oh, bullshit, mate. He said, that was assault in the first degree. And went back, got the video footage, wrote out an affidavit. This bloke had stood on my head. You're asleep, they'll keep an eye on us. And yeah, basically, you just had to pay the full of stitches and a bit of a damaged knee. I think it cost me $3,500 or $4,000 or something. And,
jeez.
2 years.
Are you lucky?
Yeah, suspended. I think it was 12 months, 2 years suspended sentence. Yeah. That was the only two times. Other than being a kid, we lived across the road from the cop shop, so.
You fucking got no hope.
No hope, no. No, no good days. Where'd we go? Where were we up to? Ravenswood, Queensland. Yeah. Then where'd we go from there? Oh, best shaft sink that I'd ever been on. I think I might have come back to Southern Cross for a little while and then back over to Osborne Shaft with Branko. And so me, Branko, were the shift bosses. And it was absolute brilliant times, eh?
Tony, so where's that? Where's Osborne Shaft?
Osborne is just outside of Concurry, Mount Isa area again.
Yeah.
It was a 900-meter handheld sink with a loading station, crusher station, steel-guided shaft. That used to run at about 18, something was supposed to run about 22, 24 meters a second. But yeah, I think they used to run at about 18, but amazing sink, eh? It was like fantastic. Like, so smashing out 2.4 meter rounds every day, concrete line, you know, you take 2-3 rounds.
Yeah. Oh, Tony Meares loves his concrete.
Oh, mate, eh? fantastic mass sinker, eh? Like, he worked us, we flogged us, but we got paid, and same thing, mate. You went down, done your job. You never heard from him, and it was always a pat on the back. And same thing, that those days, like camp life, was just so much better because you could have a bloody, you can have a beer after work. There was no drug tests. There's always no alcohol and drug tests, and you know, there was always live music and barbecues, and you know, like great crews. You know, like everyone was, you know, supported each other and looked after each other, and these days, you find on the shafts, or I've found anyway, I haven't had too many successful ones, been bushed on most of them. Like people want to climb over the top of you, mate, they don't support you, you know, like we tend to be knifing you in the back to, you know, get into your position or move forward and all that kind of shit. But Osborne, very successful shaft, mate, eh? Like no incidents, no accidents and all that kind of stuff. Put in the crush station, you know, overhead, you know, chopping up a 1700 in half and dropping it down the shaft, you know, once you establish your plat. But yeah, some Darwin Vidal, Branko, myself, Ratso Zuna, or Leo Zuna, just good men that were into it. We just smashed it, eh? Down there, like, pick up, you know, go down the aft cut, bloody, you pick up that machine and you'd be back into it. Like. The only place I've actually been stuck underground for a few days, eh? PC on the winder had gone out, and I think it was a Friday night or Friday afternoon, and they couldn't get the part up there until Monday, so we were stuck down the shaft all weekend. And it was quite interesting to see our seven blokes go with each other for 48 hours solid.
Oh, you know? Shit.
Yeah, dropping a bit of food and tucking down and getting cold and all that kind of stuff. And of course the water's creeping up, and just the silly, you know, like you go through phases, you know, a few boys would start getting silly and, you know, start doing a couple of bombies, you know, into the shaft because the water was building. And, you know, like, and, you know, then a few arguments, you know, like just difference of opinions, and, you know, like.
Yeah, it's a long time, isn't it?
Well,
so what, it was working all good. So you got down there and then it shit itself and you couldn't get out.
Yeah, PC. So they dropped an emergency cage. So we had this emergency cage, like flashed that up really, really nice and all that kind of stuff, but they'd never run it. And of course, the paint, like it was, fully, you know, thick paint and all that kind of stuff. So they went to drop the emergency kibble and all that kind of stuff and got down and hung up on the paint. And they were lucky that they caught it because they actually rope, you know, they didn't realize they actually had slack rope on the emergency cage. So they abandoned that idea. And
yeah,
he was like, "You aren't coming out." We possibly could have climbed out, but there's a couple of guys, you know, that wouldn't have been able to, you know, 600-700 meters is a fair way.
Oh, shit.
Hanging off steel.
Was it a lot? So if you're going to climb out, it's just. There was nothing to stop you falling.
No, not at all.
Oh, Jesus Christ. Yeah. That's a big climb.
It is, yeah. And like some people are comfortable. That's the thing. We were comfortable climbing around shafts and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, you're used to it, aren't you?
Yeah, but everyone's not the same. And yeah, you take that into consideration. So yeah.
Yeah.
We all sat put until they got the PC working and dragged us out.
Have you had many other bloody close calls underground? As you said, you've had a good bloody looked after yourself, good safety record.
I've been cleaned up twice, both on Alamax. So I went Alamax.
Oh, they're fucking mad, them bastards, aren't they?
Well, they aren't really. Like to me, an Alamax mine, Alamax mining is actually a safe system of work. But the problem with the way Aussies done it is that we, you know, if you have a look at the Canadians, they don't hurt anyone. They never have innocents. Never had.
Yeah, I remember you telling me that
because they use them to within 2.4. You know. To their design. The problem when the Aussies got the Alamac, they started adding wings and putting extra motors on. And next minute we're shafts.
High speed Alamac development, typical Australian. High speed,
but like we were, you know, like things where you'd usually sink a shaft or, you know, these guys putting up, you know, 4 meter diameter freaking, you know, ventilation risers climbing up on a couple of motors, 300 or 400 meters bloody high. So yeah, first time, it was actually my first time ever up on an Alamac. And this is where I love blokes like Peter Cox and guys like that. We were following these couple of Canadians who are supposed to be the guns. Got up there and their face was just, it was just shit. There was explosives hanging out of half the face. There was like big bundies hanging there. And I'd been mining a little while by then, by 8-9 years, but I'd never been on an Alamac. So I got there and looked. So you climb through a little hatch and you come up under a little keyway in the middle of your roof and it's got a little cover on it. So two of us come in there, you drop your platform and look, and it's like, don't touch that, Coxie. Yeah, it's just, holy shit, what are we going to do? Before we could do anything.
Sort of a butted up face just above your head.
Yeah, but completely like just boulders and rocks, you know, like big air. It's just like, oh my God, you know, it's like just scary to look at. But before you knew it, Coxie had touched one and the whole lot just, just swallowed that. But of course we had, I think we had a couple of decks out or a couple of wings and all that kind of stuff, and you actually have to fold those up before you travel, but you know, you've got shit ground, and then you're throwing the big rocks, like rocks as big as these chairs and tables, over the side, scale them off, and then they take, because you travel up with air, like your air hose or your 2-inch bull hose is following you out behind you, as you're throwing them off, like they cut all the air and services and all that kind of stuff down there. But the next minute I noticed like there was blood all over the deck, and I'd actually, on this ankle here, I'd actually severed my Achilles right through.
Oh.
But like because of the adrenaline and the dust and all that kind of stuff, like it was just like blood pooling out over the top of my boat.
Did it curl up your leg?
Yeah, it did. It was like it went on. But funnily enough, like so we got down, we had to wind ourselves down on the emergency brake. So what you do is you let the brake run and it takes you down and all that kind of stuff. And we got down there and someone had taken our ute and it was blood and boot, he didn't let me take my boot off because actually you pressure cut it, it actually had rolled down back of the heel and cut opened it right up like a orange wedge, and didn't let me take my boot off and got me straight over when we could get out, found a ute, got back out and all that, and they took me, raced me straight across to Meekatharra, and as I said, I really am blessed. That day there was this actual surgeon in the Meekatharra Hospital giving a course on suturing.
Oh,
no shit. And because it hadn't been that long, like a couple of hours or whatever, they'd actually were able to pull it back and sew her up. And yeah, sure enough, a month later, I was back at work.
Fuck it hell.
Yeah, he said, because a couple of days it starts to shrink. It might have been hanging on because it was 100-odd stitches in it internally, and they, so it was hanging on. And then the second time I got hurt was Alamac in Cooktown, rock had come, we were changing out a rail.
Where's Cooktown?
Collingwood, Tinmore. Cooktown's
Victoria.
Far north Queensland.
Oh, far north
Queensland. Yeah, Gulf, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, Cooktown, yeah. Well,
because you'd be cooked the whole time and be that fucking hot.
Yeah. Oh, no, it was beautiful country, mate.
Oh, was it? Yeah. Or not?
Cooktown?
Yeah.
Well, there's rivers running past you, so if you were, you'd just go and jump in the river.
Yeah, I suppose. I suppose you just got used to working in fucking far north Queensland, didn't you?
Oh, no. There's hot mines and there's hot mines. You know, like the hottest mine actually is in Australia. It is actually far north Queensland. It's out near Mount Isa and Concord. And then again, Eloise.
Mm.
Now, that place can get to, you know, 40, 50 degrees wet bulb. Yeah, like it's the only place I've ever had to take esky and towels down and sit them on top of your eyes. You'd come down out of your eyes, bore three or four holes, come down out of your eyes, just drop your helmet off, drop a towel over your head.
Cool you down. Just in and out.
Yeah, just in and out all day. Yeah, take you all day to get one cut. You just took your time.
Yeah.
Explosives bloody melted and all that kind of shit.
How'd you survive that bloody...
I didn't do it for long.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can't. Well, I couldn't have. I just found when I was laying in bed at night, you know, it didn't matter whether it was your little pinky and your foot or your
fucking hamstring, just, quad.
They're just like, just cramped. Didn't matter what you did.
Oh.
And you knew you'd be getting the shit like you'd. By the end of you'd done the fortnight, you'd be really struggling. I think I only done two swings or three swings in it. It was just too hard.
Oh, but even the first shift in trying to cope with that shit, like,
yeah,
you're just like fucking hopeless.
I worked in hotter though, man. The hottest mine I've worked in is over in Halmahera in Indonesia with Paddy Grealish. We had a small crew over there, and we used to have to put in the standpipes to dewater. Like, we used to try and keep in front of the jumbos a couple of levels by dewatering the. Of course, they'd have to be cut first, your jumbo cut first, but
They'd
go as far as they possibly could, and then we'd put a borehole down, and we'd try and pump the water, because if you got rid of the water, you'd drop temperature by about 10 or 20 degrees.
Oh, right.
And yeah, it could take us all day, I mean, like 70-degree wet bulb, like without exaggeration, 70-degree wet bulb, take all day to put in four bolts. Yeah. But usually what you find, things would start melting before you. Oh. Like, so your pumps would only last in there, maybe 3-4 days or 5 days. So everything had to be really efficient, because the actual wiring in your pumps would melt before you could, and then you'd have to go and change it out again.
Oh, you're made from different shit to me. How the fuck do you even walk? I couldn't even walk out of the ute into that stuff.
Well, it was amazing, because I was paid like most I've ever been paid in my whole career. It was like over 300 a year kind of thing. Never had an incident, never had an accident, but we done a few things wrong. First, we set up, like a refuge chamber, and I bring all ice and all that kind of stuff. So, you know, you think cooling yourself down and all that kind of stuff, but that actually made things worse. So what I used to do is just make the guys go in and out, you know, sit outside for 10 minutes, and we used to have a whiteboard, and you'd write, you know, like run your hoses, you know, clip your machine, the next bloke would go out, get a collar. Like for three or four until they could bear it. And you just run with 5-minute sessions every half hour.
Yeah.
Yeah, to try and get your water. Get your bore pumping that in.
Isn't it funny when you're doing that, like you're teetering on the edge of death the whole time. Like, you know, when you do like 5 minutes, if you stayed for 10, you'd be probably dead. Like, well, not dead, but if you stayed for an hour, you'd probably...
You did see a lot of burns in that there, like, because the water, we were a couple hundred Ks or 100 Ks from a volcano, and I think that's why it was so rich in gold and all that kind of stuff. It was Newmont site. And, 1,000 gram sort of dirt, bloody most headings, and... you get rid of the water and you cool your mind. But they, like, even the jumbo faces and all that kind of stuff, like, the boys were down there, you know, in the undies, like, bloody, you know, boring their cuts and all that kind of stuff with your ventilation tied to the back of your cabin.
Yeah, right.
They got through it. And even the faces, you weren't allowed to charge those specific faces until they got below 65-degree wet bulb. Yeah. You know, like, so the poor guys, they was just like, but there was no pressure on you to, you know, if you charged... You know, it took you all day to charge your car. That's what it took, you know. There was no one. Get the fuck out there, you weak bastards.
Yeah.
It was interesting. And that was a fantastic job. Lost a mate after that, actually, from there. Who was there? Me. So the three shift bosses were Pat Sweeney, myself, and Johnny McNabb. And Johnny McNabb, he passed. God bless him. He was a nice guy, fantastic man, eh? Yeah, back in, he was living up in the highlands of NZ somewhere. And, with his electric eels, I was a bit of an eccentric sort of a bloke. But yeah, he passed a couple of years back. So, here's to you, Johnny. Yeah, good man.
Yeah.
But yeah, that was one of the new Halmahera, and it was fantastic. Like, because the locals, So all green crew, no one ever been mining and all that kind of stuff. So it was me and one lead miner, Indonesian. I had a Agus Pratino, fantastic gentleman, and he was the only bloke that could speak English there, or a little bit. Oh, no. Yeah, he could understand me. And then you had four Muslims and four Christians, so that there's always someone at work. And
Of course,
because they have their days off and that. Yeah. But they were just got them through unscathed, went the whole 13 months incident free. So they gave me another 30,000 cash for the month. I was like, hey, bonus, this is awesome.
Fucking beautiful.
That was after 12 months. And then because I'd trained everyone up so well, they were all competent shaft sinkers. By the time I'd left, they didn't need me. Whereas Sweeney, the bloody prick, he got to stay off another 12 months because he didn't teach his boys anything. Like Pat Sweeney. Smart Irishman.
Yeah.
Great bloke, though. Pat, you don't get better men than Pat. Fantastic guy. Yeah. No, a lot of good years, mate.
Is that the only overseas one you did?
Most of my overseas gigs haven't been successful.
You did.
I done Hong Kong with Ruck.
Yeah, that's right.
I went over to Grasberg, which is incredible experience. It was I'm so glad I've been seeing the biggest underground mine in the world. That's where, they just line jumbos up, man. You can't break them. They just get you another one. Get an old jumbo out of the store. You'd be right.
Yeah. Yeah, I've heard that.
Yeah, it was. Unbelievable. Concrete, 10,000 cubic meter for pores. Incredible. Just the size and the amount of people. The day that I rocked up there, I think there was 30,000 people walking out on strike over the hill down to. So my first month there was most of the locals were on strike and were doing, courses in, talk to people, treat people, that kind of stuff, your respectful courses, all that kind of stuff, getting your driver's license and all that, which is quite a main feat. Everything over there is about 1 in 9, 1 in 10, driving around, they put concrete down with ribs so you can get up to and from the mines. And,
oh, right.
Yeah, 5,000 people going to work at a time. It was absolute mayhem. And if you have a look at the photos, I've still got a couple of mates on Messenger and YouTube. Most of it comes through LinkedIn. How well they're doing and how good of a job Barry set that up to be.
Yeah.
Yeah, because Barry was the main role over there.
Mm. What's some of the best, what would you put down the best joints you've lived and worked at over the time? Because a lot of your stuff is residential, as you said.
Yeah.
Like a lot more community than the week on, week off side of things, FIFO.
Gympie, without any shadow of doubt, best mine I worked in. Same thing, two.
Because what's happening with that now? Is that restarting, someone said?
I don't think they ever could.
2 hours north of Brizzy, eh?
Basically, yeah. Beautiful mine, quartz gold. Quartz ore bodies. I don't think you can keep up with the water there, Matt. They do believe that there's gold in the black shale right at the bottom of it. Peter Ferguson told me they hit quite a strong load there just before it closed. But I think what happened with Gympie was initially you had so many people on the workers' comp, it was a small operating mine. There's a lot of people, over the years, could have been running for 20 or 30 years, were, still on that. I think it just all got out of control, it was mining. I don't know, I'm not a manager, but working, what it costs you to actually operate the mine was very minimal. But brilliant, absolutely brilliant. You were Noosa, an hour down the road.
Oh, fucking how dangerous is that?
Oh, mate, it was bloody absolutely brilliant. And then you had the Sandy Straits, Tin Can Bay, Rainbow Beach, Fraser Island, 40 minutes the other way.
Yep.
So every weekend, we're out camping or holidaying. But
so it's just Monday to, you're doing Monday. Yeah,
Monday
Friday.
Monday to Saturday. Monday, I think you didn't have to do every Saturday. You'd have a long weekend every third weekend. But you had to throw in a Sunday every month to go and clean all your rail because you're the rail mine. But some of the best men there, same thing. I could ride my push bike, drop my kids off at school, ride my push bike to the brace, start work, knock off, 4 o'clock, pick them up on the way home, just brilliant. Eight hour days, man, I don't care what anyone says, for a community, being community orientated, involved, bringing up family and all that kind of stuff. You can't beat 8 hour day being home every night.
Yeah.
Best days of my life.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mary River alongside through Gympie. you know, kayaking every weekend or canoeing, and just a real fit, real, just a real fit place, you know, like that hilly, you know, you're riding bikes and, you know, being adventurous. Without any shadow of doubt, Gympie is the best mine that I've ever worked in.
Yeah.
Yeah. All around good blokes. Same thing, you know, like we're all getting paid good money, but the other best part about it, we used to have our boss, Ian Kidd Mining, or that's who we work for, he used to give us about $10,000 every 3 months. So with that $10,000, there was a crew of, what was it, about 12 of us, 15 of us? And that's not all, you know. And, yeah, so we'd bring the penthouse playmates up from Gold Coast, or hire a houseboat with a few skimpies going up the Sandy Straits, or over to the Brisbane Trots for a weekend.
Spend it wisely.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, the penthouse playmates up from Gold Coast was a bloody top night. Yeah, it was. We had to shut that down. It got a bit out of control. Well, of course, once the pub shut and they found out there was a limousine there full of bloody some of the sexiest goddamn women in Queensland at my joint. It was, yeah, they all started coming pretty fast. It was like, see you later, boys, we're out of here. Yeah, lock the front gate, then a few guards, get out. But same thing too, strong foreman, mate. Well, we had Bill Edgerton and Stevie Reimer and old Kalgoorlie, you know, boys, and that, and just no nonsense, strong foreman, you know, like, yeah, if you were talking to me, you were in shit, but like it was such a well-run mine, but it was probably the last flat-out rail mine in Australia in 2001. I think we mined it through to about 2008, 2009, something like that. And
yep.
Brilliant. You know, like everyone that come on my crew, I'd make them do a shift on the Grizzly just so I knew about it. If you had a smart arse, you'd put an extra couple hundred mil on the holes and,
yep.
Yeah, send them out a bit bigger. If you're running late or trying to get your five cuts, you know, bunched her up and, you know, made it small so you didn't have to stand on that Grizzly for frigging 3 hours smashing big rocks.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You had a few weak blokes knock themselves out and drop their handles and all that kind of stuff, but drop the spoilers down the Grizzly. So, and then as soon as that happens, you know, you can't stop, of course, so it starts piling up and then you're all out there at 3 o'clock trying to lift a few rail to get the bigger ones down.
Yeah.
But all you're doing is stuffing up and skipping on the level below if you're doing that. So, no, it's just a good fun mine. Yeah.
So that got just mined out or like just deep, too much water, did you say? Or
I actually left before it had finished on a pretty bad note kind of stuff. Yeah, but we won't even go there. It was I basically got out of town there, got out of Dodge.
Oh right.
Yeah, a few dramas and all that kind of stuff. So yeah, moved on to better things. Yeah.
Safer pastures.
Yeah, safer pastures, things like that. But the town, the Gympie Gold, yeah, nah, thank you. It was, Gympie was amazing. Some great blokes. Mickey Nolan that wrote that, Silver Lady.
Yeah.
Brownie, Chris Bentley, Robbie Alford. So this, one of the saddest things that happened there was Robbie Wickham. This guy was an Alamac miner. Brilliant. Him and Sam Carroll, both passed now. Poor buggers, God bless him. They were good men, but like full on. Hey, Rob, if you sat at a table with Rob, you know, like how your cheeks just smile, you know, you hurt from smiling so much, or you know, have you ever had that? Like, you know, when you sit at a table with someone, they just make you laugh and smile that much that you're hurting.
Yeah.
That was Robbie Wickham, you know, 7 days of a bloody week. You know, if you spoke to him, you're always smiling and laughing. Even thinking about him brings a smile to your face. But yeah, he took his own life tragically. Back over here, just end up, you know, all getting too much for him and all that kind of stuff. I think Sam Carroll, another fantastic bloke, and they used to Alamac together there. I think he might have got killed in a car accident. I don't know exactly, but yeah.
Yeah.
They both passed, yeah. Good men. Yeah, though, Robbie Wick and myself, so on that houseboat party, so we hired that houseboat, go up Sandy Straits and all that kind of stuff. Oh, man, eh? Like, so they're jet boating 18-gallon kegs up the bloody Sandy Straits to us when we run out of piss and all that kind of stuff. But coming back, I think it's, you know, 2 days. We're allowed 2 or 3 days to get back. You're only going up to Kingfisher Bay Resort, which is on the Fraser Island, coming back. And, of course, we're punching the current, punching the tide. We should have probably just parked up and, you know, wait for the tide to turn. But anyway, Robbie decides to jump off the boat, you know, like drunk. We might have even fallen off, or he's doing it by me or something. Of course, his boat's facing this way. The current's running. You know, there are those tides over there, 4 or 5 metre tide. So,
yeah.
And there's big bloody sharks and that, all that kind of stuff. And now I've seen Robbie go over, it's like, you bloody deal, mate. So I was like, threw the red boy over and knew he wasn't going to make it. So I jumped in after him while the boys, they took us. By the time they caught up with us, we were pushing out that bloody fast, like in this bloody river. I just said, Rob, kick back, put your legs up on there, mate, relax, talk to me. Hey, he would have drowned for sure. He was hopeless, eh? Turn this boat around. We had to start the whole voyage all over again. Like, do it again. We're tying you up. Yeah. Yeah, a lot of stupid bloody things like that.
Oh.
And also Peter Ferguson. Peter Ferguson was there. He was a guy. Peter Ferguson is probably one of the best men that I've ever met. There's so many Peters in my life, mate. I've got to give them all credit. So there's Peter Kovic, who's probably the best winder driver in the world. I'd say in the world. Peter Ferguson, Peter Cox, Peter Castles, always Peter's all done something with me first. But Peter Ferguson, who was a Gympie miner or a Herbert and Tin miner, he was a soldier and he'd come out of the services to go back mine or to go mining. I met him when I was an apprentice in the carpenter shop up at KMA. Like I used to replace all the spoiler handles and Gympie handles and sharpen the chainsaws and hand saws. That was your first job in the morning. And apparently I was taking too much off him. And so he actually came into the carpenter shop. He was working over at Lakeview. And I made one up specifically for him and gave it to him. So there you go, stop your engine, rah, rah. Yeah, he's a big man. And then met him in Bellevue, first time I'd ever put in a spit set with an air leg. And then first shaft sink, first vertical rise, I'd all done with Peter Ferguson. And he was the bloke that sorted me out in Gympie. Told me to, you know, go and buy a house, stop being so stupid and get your shit together. Yeah, Peter Kovic, like I said, he was the best winder driver in the country. He was the first bloke to give me any financial advice. Peter Cox, first bloke I ever went in an Alamac with. Peter Castles, he was the first underground miner that ever slapped me across the ear. Give me a box of matches and said, that's what a rise is supposed to look like. If I see any different, you'll get another one.
Yeah. It's a good bloody rundown.
Oh, it's been a great adventure, mate, eh? But, yeah, sad for all the mates that we've lost over the years, absolutely beautiful, mate, eh?
Yeah.
Well, that North Queensland, it is a beautiful country. You know, I've fished up there with Grant Polkey and those guys, eh, like up the Gregory River, you know, sat in water half a metre deep, you know, with a fishing line on, and honestly, had a blue wren land on my shoulder, or, you know, been up to, you know, up above Townsville, you know, throwing a cast net around to, you know, cook your prawns on a bloody, you know, over a fire on a pot to have, you know, be surrounded by fireflies or, yeah. You know, Collingwood Tin Mine Cooktown, I actually seen one of those coloured pythons, you know, like a blue python, you know, up on its back tail, like hovering through the air, chasing a butterfly. I've seen some amazing, Armidale, New South Wales.
Hillgrove. Yeah, yeah.
You know,
the first one I ever worked at.
Sat, you know, I was sitting down at a water tank down there on the deep, you know, in front of the decline, and, you know, spotted quolls, you know, walk past you. You know, like it's just like, wow, check that out.
Oh, cold, fucking cold joint, that joint.
What an amazing story, man. This is where I think you're wasting your time talking to blokes like me, and you should actually be following that mining history up, is because, you know, like that history of that Hillgrove mine, you know, like, those Chinese that were working down there, you know, chasing out, you know, we didn't even know about antimony and gold, you know, like carrying that up. What's that gorge about? 300-400 meters deep?
Oh, it's fucking, yeah.
Carrying that ore, carrying their mining tools down that gorge, you know, like I know it's no different from carrying your mining tools out to a lunar walking across the desert, but, you know, like it's all pretty tough going, but.
Not like carrying, carrying your bloody 40-50k up the bloody road at Kew or whatever. But
that was just walking, eh? Yeah. I'm doing a. Me and the missus, we're doing a kimono walk in a month's time, I think. We'll walk.
Oh, you'd be seasoned.
665. Yeah, yeah. Marlene's better at it than me. But, yeah, that history of Armidale, New South Wales, or Hillgrove, New South Wales, is unbelievable. You know, like the river, you go down that gorge and you got this perfect river and you can pan off gold down there all day. And
no good when she rains. You got to get the grader down to fucking get
You sit up on the side of one of those adats, you'll be fine, eh?
Yeah.
You keep going. But even
I think it's back up and going, isn't it?
They're going really well. No, because they stuffed up. They had a good mill and all that there, but of course it was out of date and they tried putting a new one in there and they end up stuffing that up because it was plastic or something like that. And, but, yeah, it's good to see that they're up and running. Well, Peter, actually, that was another Peter. He actually gave me a start there at Hillgrove working there. But even the history
Which Peter was that?
Peter Ganser.
Ganser, yeah. He was the one there that I was there. He was the underground manager when I was there.
Peter Gansel, I think.
He's over here now.
Is he?
He's at, who's he with? Saracen. It was Saracen, but obviously not anymore. He's with someone else then. He was with Saracen Tech Services. He was with Goldfields. I don't know. Peter, if you're listening, give us a buzz. I want to catch up with you.
He actually was on that Osborne shaft, and like strong leader, like good, you know, like just straight up, no nonsense, you know, like, yeah. I think that's why things run so well. Starts at the top. It was good.
What about Victoria? Did you do much down
there?
Yeah,
mate. Yeah, Victoria, beautiful country. Loved it. So we were over there at A1 Gold Mine, which is Woods Point, and probably the prettiest, other than Cooktown, probably the prettiest town I've actually ever been in for mining. So you follow this beautiful river. I forget the name of it, but you turn left at, so you're heading out to Mount Buller and then you're Mansfield. Turn right at Mansfield and you head up to the highlands, up to this Wood Points, but they still do not have satellites up there for mobile phone coverage. So keeping young blokes and all that kind of stuff is pretty hard because there's no, everyone's on their phones these days. They can't live without them. But the mine, it's all nuggety, you know, gold, and a lot of good miners up there now. So some of the greatest blokes I work with, Roger Hendy, Peter, Trevor Smith, Peter Cox, you know, all those old boys, all those old leggers are up there, you know, handheld mining still at the A1 mine, which is the oldest operating mine in Australia. So I think it's ran the most consecutively, like since it opened in 1897 or 1901 or whatever it was. It's always, I think it only ever shut down for 10 years. So they've still got an internal winder in there.
Yeah, right.
You can go through, find the old dynamite and levels. So, it was raped and pillaged sometime by a few miners that just went in there, took high-grade gold out and all that kind of stuff, and then shut it down. They shut it down for a while because the grade wasn't, you know, they couldn't find the grade, but they're doing some great work up there.
Yeah, right.
If you ever get a chance, call in and have a look at it. It is beautiful.
Okay, there. What about... did you work it? Because I'll go and interview buddy. Making the big flight to Stall next in a couple of weeks to go see Dave Butler.
Dave Butler, what a legend.
That'll be a good yarn. Did you do any rock drill comps?
Yeah, I've done a couple of rock drill. I never took them seriously. The only time I ever won one, I think I had the mine manager backing me at Gympie Gold, like brought me in the sweep and all that kind of stuff.
And the cow cutter.
And I bloody, I think I actually won the heat with a good time, but I got disqualified for not wearing my safety glasses, which would have been fucking typical, mate.
Yeah, you would have told him to fuck off as well.
No, I didn't say that. It was just like, so Dave, me and Dave actually got a lot of good history. And he used to actually, he was that fit as a young man that he actually used to run up the side of the open cut before we could drive up there. That's how he was a strong, fit bloke. He was a machine, man.
Yeah.
But a good bloke to boot. He was a big ego, like, mate, anyone that's good at anything has got to have a bit of an ego.
Yeah.
I'll be down, Dave, when you see us. He's going to flog me. But, strong rock drawer. Not as good as his mate, Fellows. Colin Fellows, he was bloody good. But they were all good in the day. They all won different events.
Because he's a Tassie, I think, Colin. Yeah, he's trying to. Dave, give me he's got the stats. He's got the stats. He's outdone Colin apparently in the rock drills.
They wouldn't like to be. None of them like to be beaten. All those Tasmanian boys are pretty competitive.
That's gonna be a fucking good yarn. I can't wait for that.
But that is a great day if you ever got the opportunity. So it's in December and they have the wood chopping. So that's what you love about Tasmania's community and that over there. But they have the wood chopping, the rock drill. You know, like a dog, kelpie, rounding up sheep. You know, it's just a fantastic day. I did win a win event over there. It was doubles with some old fella. We smashed it. I'd like, got a bit of prize money.
Well, I think it sounded like he nearly made a career out of it for a bit. Like
a lot of them did.
With all the rock drills fucking comps around the bloody country.
No, I never got into anything like that. It was always, I was, you know, in town while there was a rock drill on. So, have a crack.
Yeah.
I've won, third or fourth prize and novices or anything. I've never ever won one.
Yeah.
Other than doubles comp in Tasmania. I think that was still novices.
Can you pinpoint in this whole career, I guess, the the best fight you've been in and the best fighter you've had to fight against? Out of all these fucking floggings you've been given and dished out or whatever, there'd have to be some standouts.
Okay, there was. So they have a Queensland Tough Man competition in Townsville every year. And I've by no means or any way, shape or form a fighter. Like I've never ever, you know, won a couple of fights.
But you'd be a biter or something. No, you'd do whatever it takes to win.
I don't like hurting people. I really do not like hurting. I've never hurt anyone if I could help it other than probably your heart, you know, if your heart's broken, but and I'll throw that out there. But so we're in the Ravenswood Hotel and there was a bloke there called Derek who was a tough man competitor. Pretty fit sort of bloke. And before work, because we were living at the pubs at Ravenswood in Queensland.
Yep.
It was always, you know, mum drew, oh, your mum wear gum boots or your mum, you know, like shag such and such, or your mum's lousy, you know, whatever. Anyway, I don't know, sometimes I just like snap, you know, someone said something about my mum and next minute, bang, like I've just launched myself off the bar at him and we've rolled through the dining room by just smacking the shit out of each other down this massive flight of back. So I threw the kitchen where the cook was going off and nutting and flogging us with a broom on the way through and down the back stairs and ended up on the back lawn in the clothesline. And this old girl, and no shit, man, she actually literally took to us with a broom. Like she was smacking us both on the head that hard that we, like, we had to stop the fight. Like it was came. We all had big lumps all over her head, eh? Like she actually, that was probably the best scrap I'd ever been. Like longest, you know, duration. We've got a few punchings, but we both got to end up getting belted by this 80-year-old lady with a broom. Mess up my kitchen. Yeah. Other than that, they're all bloody, more just pain or
bugger. Who's some of the best bloody air leg brawlers you've ever seen?
Oh,
they could hold themselves.
Well, see, none of us really, see, like all the tough
guys. Fucking farmers in North Queensland, they're the bloody ones.
Basically, Grant Polky, Randy Crumblin, like were tough men. Like they're all Sydney siders, or one Polky was from Sydney. Like I seen him lay out a few coppers. I wouldn't let anyone else get involved in his fight. Like he just knew how to, he just knows how to punch.
That like salt, big pole.
I'd back him against most people. Eh? Like this guy is just phenomenal. Like he gave me a blood blister there from about where you were sitting once, just one crack. Eh?
Yeah.
Randy Crumblin, amazing tough mate. But you got to remember, there's a lot of, SAS soldiers, that are, air leggers or, been air legging across the injuries. Peter Cernak, like those crazy Slavs in the early days, they just used to, get a gut full of piss and want to punch on with every man, dick and every, but no one wins them. Like no one ever, they're not fights. It's, we used to be able to have a fight. Like even myself, like I've had a few fights in the change rooms over the years and, you get up and, you dust yourself off and you have a laugh about it the next day, they're not.
Yeah.
Yeah, so as much as you, having a game, I'm sorry, even Justin, it was funny, it was well deserved, He knocked out for facing, he never put a lucky man on his ass again. Like all the fights are usually over, like I said, over here, started with over pool tables and bloody women, they're usually nothing, too bloody serious. You never ever really fought at work, if you did have those arguments. I did get into a good dust up underground at Foster Shaft when I was a young man. So, of course, three of us, it was just a three-man crew and we're all been living, you're sharing every night with each other and all that kind of stuff. And I discussed something with the bloke I was working with, Wayne, his name was, a Kiwi fella. And he gave me shit for the next couple of days about it anyway until I finally cracked underground and we were into it and all that kind of stuff. And it actually started in the cage. We used to get it on the 21 level, I think it was, at Foster Shaft. And we punched on in the cage all the way to the surface. And we got broken up as we come to the surface because otherwise we'd both all getting kicked out. And then in the car park again after work. And then when we got back to camp, actually Jeff had a couple of sets of boxing gloves in his room and he put those on and made us hop in our donga for a half hour and both come out hugging each other.
It took a while to get out of his system.
Poor Jeff, he died in Kambolda Singleman's quarters. was, that was sad.
Yeah.
He was our foreman, or like overseas to run the crew. So yeah. He had me, Jeff and Wayne at Foss Shaft looking after, kept all the maintenance on the shaft, scaling the salt off the walls or greasing the ropes or keeping the dirt out from underneath the counterweights on the bottom of the shaft.
Yeah.
Shit work, shit job. But yeah, it's interesting.
Yeah.
That was a funny story. One of the funniest things I've ever seen there was a bloke called Donnie Smith, Cambodian. He used to be the bloke on the side of the road with his video taking it to the crackers each Friday night. You know, if he ran out of money, because he only got paid fortnightly. So yeah. One day he'd be there with his pay, the next day he'd be there with his video and TV. And then, you know, But anyway, so one night there, so we must come in the morning, it was Saturday morning. Donnie had been to the pub straight and like left the Kembolder Swinging Arms Hotel and all that kind of stuff. And he's gone straight to work in his silver slacks, pink shirt, thrown his hard hat on and his bloody belt and all that kind of stuff, and gone down to the 21 level there and put the cage on 8 bells. When the cage goes on 8 bells, you're not allowed to move the cage until, you know, 5 bells is given to release it. Anyway, so Donnie's gone down there, put the cage on 8 bells, passed out cold. Like, I mean, and he must have just crashed, eh? Because look, they were ringing the bells and passing, you know, like, could not get hold of him at all, eh? So there's 100 guys on the brace the next morning, ready to go to work, and Donnie's still asleep. So the poor manager, Gunther, I think his name was Gunther, something like that, he climbed, had to drive down the decline, then climb from the decline flat down to the bottom of the shaft to go and wake Donnie up, take the cage off 5 bells and bring him to the surface. And of course there was a, you know, 100 guys to cheer him on and, you know, give him a big clap. And when he came out of the cage, he still had his like super slacks on and his silver shirt and his whole, he must have fallen asleep under one of those salt, you know, crystal lights, because his whole beard was white and salted up. He's all got salt all over him. Everyone's like, hey, Donnie. Yeah, they give him 3 months off for it. He never really got sacked in those mines. He just got, yeah. Moved
on or bloody depart. I put a post out, because you wouldn't have bloody Facebook and all that shit.
No, I don't know. No.
Oh, you'd be glad to know. I'll spread your name around it. I put a thing out saying who wants to ask bloody questions of Mr. Eric. there was a couple.
Too dangerous.
Or he's. There's actually some kudos. You might even bloody like to hear these. Dylan James Murdoch, one of the best blokes I've met underground. Plenty of advice, yada, yada. Bloody Dylan James. No. People have got weird names on Facebook now. They're not actually their fucking names.
Oh.
Jacob Giles. Ask him what the dodgiest thing he has ever done.
Dodgiest thing I've ever done. Okay.
He says, I don't know what it is, but it would be wild.
Yeah, well, two dodgy events. So the first one was loading. Stan Gilman come past and he said, Eric, on all it, because everyone used to have a party magazine.
Yeah.
So, and of course, you know, after a couple of weeks or after a month, you know, all your old exposures start to stack up and people with debts, you know, come off because you're always in a hurry. Yeah. No one to use them. So grabbed all, he said, clean that friggin' magazine up, Christ's sake, Eric. So grabbed all my explosives, like old half bags, ampho, bloody.
Where was this at?
In Transvaal, Southern Cross.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Sorry, yeah, yeah. And, of course, loaded all my reamers up, loaded these reamers up with bloody all this old explosives and all that kind of stuff, and let it go. Of course, all powder fuses that day, so all the boys were waiting out the main drive for us and all that kind of stuff. And so I lit the powder fuse, hopped on the back of the ute, and we'd only just started moving up the decline, and every bit of vent bag, services, I think we dropped the fan. The fan actually fell off one eye pin. One eye pin actually come off out of the fan. The fan was hanging there just about dropping the bloody ute. That's how hard it is, eh? I was like, God, you know, well, you learn with explosives, eh? Like, explosives is a learning curve, because none of us really know that much about them until you've done 30 years of underground mining and seen all the things, stupid things that happen over the years.
Yeah.
And the second most dodgiest thing was all the boys at Osborne, we were shift changing. And of course, we've got to take the brand new troop carrier out on a bloody yabbying mission. So we've we've all jumped in the PC, and Big Matty Lever was driving. He's our winder driver. He's driving the bloody PC, and he's getting quite drunk and all that kind of stuff. So I was like, Matt, out, I'm driving. And I'm pretty drunk, and had a bit of chuff and all that kind of stuff myself. And we'd gone up onto the edge of the dam. And as I've come over the top, you get big washouts and all that kind of stuff. And I only had one option not to roll the vehicle, and that was to basically go into the dam. So brand new PC, troop carry. And I did deserve to get dismissed over this because you can't just do this shit. So that wasn't the end of it. So, of course, we're 30K or 10K from the mine. So it's like, I stuffed up, boys, grab me water bottle, rah, rah, you guys hang here. I'll walk back to the mine, go and get a truck or something and pull us out over there. Damn, I get lost in the scrub, don't I? Fucking 45 degrees in Spinifex country walking back to the mine. So, of course, they've come out because before you leave the mine, you actually have to give a time where you're going to be and, what time you're coming back and all that kind of stuff. And so they've gone out looking for us, and I'm still not back in camp. But they found all the boys, my whole crew's just as red as your bush chook shorts there, Matty, and still drunk. And, of course, they've done bombies off the brand new troopy into the bloody dam and caved all the roofing and all the empty beer cans are floating. I've got a couple of good photos that they sent me. All that kind of stuff. But in the meantime, I'm still wandering around, and then I finally heard the mine, heard it and walked in the camp. And as soon as I got in there, the old foreman, Tiger Dolphin, I think his name was. Yeah, he didn't go much on me, He was into me. Fucking you, bloody dickhead. Rah, rah, rah. We expect more out of you. I was like, fair enough, Tiger. I said, it was a stuff up, man. I was like, stuff up, you're on the fucking next plane out of here. So that was my...
What happened to the rest of them?
They were
under your wing.
Yeah, they had a shaft finish, and that was and it was right at the end of it. Thank Christ, because it was my most successful shaft sink, and it was brilliantly done. Yeah,
yeah.
And I just didn't get to see the opening ceremony of the winder driving 24 meters.
Got a bit too excited. Got a bit too
there. Yeah. But yeah, at the same time, we didn't. Other than the caved in roof, we didn't bloody didn't do too much other damage, other than a few blisters and all that kind of stuff. But that Spinifex country is. That is horrible shit to walk through.
Oh.
Yeah, that is, yeah. No, it's, I can understand why people perish out there, eh?
Oh, yeah, fuck yeah. That.
It was a silly, very, very silly. That was my biggest stuff up.
Oh, well, last one, buddy, I won't go. This bloke's giving me way too much information for the fucking role he's got. Trust me, so I won't mention specifics, so, because I'd be thanks me for this. I'll filter it out. I'll show you afterwards.
Yeah.
All it was, the one bit I ask, he wants to know what you brush your teeth with, because he reckons there's something you should change it because it has a bad relationship with the breathalyzer each morning. Apparently, the rest of it's too specific. I've taken a mature approach and not going to ask.
Okay, cool. So I was blowing numbers every morning there for a while, and I was using the spearmint, what do you call it, mouthwash?
Listerine.
Listerine, and then because I was doing it in camp, I wasn't, so I'd go and brush.
So you do it straight away.
Yeah, I was brushing my teeth and then walking out the front and having a dart on the way and blowing numbers. I blew numbers for about five times in a row, six times in a row there. It was just like, one more time, Eric, and we're going to, do the old test on you, all that kind of stuff. It's like, whatever, I'm not drinking. I only ever have two beers or four beers a night in camp, so you're not over. Unless Branko's out there, that's why I stay away from the bar.
Oh, yeah, once he gets on the fucking red wine and everything. Yeah. He is speaking of getting excited. Mm. He's fucking – he come over for a beer a month or two ago. His buddy missus come with it and everything. They had somewhere to go, and she's trying to drag him out. He's like, one more. Couldn't get rid of him. He was fucking – this cold schooners. He was just fucking throwing him down. Loved it. And then he went to the Croatian club till fucking midnight or something. So he had a bloody great time.
He's a wonderful man. You like – your interview didn't actually do him justice, I don't think, because he's a guy, his whole career – has just done for others, or been that
very generous person, very, isn't
mate. Like that street person that it actually brings a tear to my eye. I think that he went out of his way to a bloke that he met on the streets of Fremantle, went out of his way to actually give him a proper state, a proper burial, not just a thrown into a cardboard box into a incinerator, because that's exactly what would have happened to him, because a street person with no family.
Yeah.
You know. yeah, gave him a headstone and a proper burial, you know, like how many people do that kind of shit? You know,
nah. Or you ain't go around to his place and like the fucking food he puts on for you, like so generous. Like they're just that's their culture, but
always been a real giving soul. And you know, everything he does at work is always right. You know, like he just does it 100% correct. And even shafting, cross shifting, he's probably one of the best cross shifts that I've ever had in my career. You know, like as far as you know, like being you know something I fail to realize these days. We're always taught you only ever as good as your cross shift. You know, you usually
don't have cross shifts when you're air legging.
No, but like even the shafts or, like in all the other small jobs that you're doing, you leave your setup. So basically all you had to do is, get on there, hop on your machine, away you'd go, So we just smashed it, eh? Yeah. Cross shifts and him was just an absolute pleasure.
Yeah.
Here's to you, Branko, you mad bugger.
Because I asked him about his pattern when he goes to do arise like his day, like map out your day.
Yep.
I remember you saying, like, oh, I'm erratic as fuck. I don't have, like, do you have a pattern you bloody do for arise and everything? Or you?
No, you go up there, your water scale, you sit down, your bloody. So, water scale while you're washing out, your water's washing out. You usually have a dart, you fill your oil bottle, all that kind of stuff, and you carry your machine down. But when you've been doing one job specifically for 20 years, if anyone's got it down packed, there's Branko. You know, he's been in that mine.
Oh, because he's like, I eat half my sandwich and I do that and I go back and do this. Yeah. I go eat the other half. Like, he has got it that fucking down
packed. You know that he done night shift last week?
Did he?
For the first time in about 15 or 16 years. Oh, like, he had this mob up there. Oh, he didn't mind because the soccer was on.
Australia
and Croatia.
He would have been, the sun would have been come over. He would have been on the piss flat out.
Yes.
Fuck, he's not allowed to take fucking grapper up there.
or anything like that. No, he wouldn't be guilty of that, of course. No, nothing like that. He just does everything right. And he's always just such a, giving, smiling, he's always a pleasure to see.
How are you, mate?
Few people like that up there.
Because how do you like when you say he does it right and you talk about people breaking dirt and what makes a fucking the best air legger? Like, if you're going to rank air leggers in terms of output, tidiness, everything.
I've seen some incredible guys over the years. You know, like, I've met blokes that can drop 5 cuts in an 8-hour day. It's because they're just into it, mate. They don't stop. You know, like, I've worked alongside guys, and you're walking, like, you walk at a normal pace out off a plat or something like that. These guys just walk past you. You know, like, they use one steel, it's just like, they don't use guide steels or mark up their faces or anything like that. It's just boom, boom, boom. Like a hole's only 6-7 minutes. Some country 3 or 4 minutes. So it's only ever 12 holes or 14 holes. So, like there's about 50, 40 minutes there out of charge. Like they're just that strong and fit that they can just boom, 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 boom. And depending on the country is how many holes they put in. So, the strongest air leg miner I have ever seen was probably Ian Kidd mining. That guy could turn 5-6 cuts in an 8-hour day by just
like 5-footers or
buddy? No, two meteries. Two meter
pilot hole or
no pilot hole, mate.
Yeah. Reamers, bloody post holes.
Yeah. He actually used to bore post hole wedge kind of thing. So like 1-4, basically. Yeah. I'm not sure exactly how he done it, but 5 cuts by a day. You go, I'll show you rising. Well, I've only just been, best I've ever done is 3, you can get your 3 if you don't mind doing the extra hour. But I'm too pedantic with scaling. I've had a couple come down off the top of your face and all that kind of stuff. So I don't start my machine until I've, a lot of those boys wouldn't even think about taking a bar or hammering a face off and all that kind of stuff.
Oh, they just straight up water into it.
When you're doing that, you don't even water, mate. Eh? It's just basically air on into a
fuck. Mm. Jesus, bloody game of them. Fucking, well, yeah, that's game.
Well, if you're pulling your cuts and that's the best part about air leg mining. You're up close and personal. Usually you can feel and see everything around you. You can touch everything, So, you feel a bit of vibration through a rock while you're running in your hole. You're tapping it off or something like that. There's nothing.
I suppose when it's at 50 to 60 degrees, you've got a bit of.
Oh, there's no, there is no. I've never actually. So all the people that I've ever seen hurt in rise miners are usually like silly accidents. Like I've seen blokes with with a trigger up their nose, standing over the machine, the trigger's gone straight up their nose, or another bloke with his hair, stuck in the bloody bridle of a machine. Steel snap through your knuckle, but rising itself, you don't Yeah, you don't fall. It's pretty hard. It's actually hard to hurt yourself. Like the pinch points are the things that get you, or, you know, lifting, incorrect lifting techniques. But that's why I said it takes you, you know, 6-7 years to actually learn. You know, like the first 6-7 years of rise mining is quite
a battle. Oh, she's painful.
Oh, it's a real battle. But if you've got good teachers that, you know, like we were taught straight away, you know, you never ever hang on to that machine. You know, like that air leg, it's all you're doing is adjusting your leg. You know, once you're in that first foot, you don't touch your machine. So I've never, I do suffer from white finger a little bit, but what will get me is the dusty, dirty environment that you're working all the time, plus the smoking and all the rest of
it. Nah, smoke, buddy, that protects your lungs.
Well, it does, I've got uncles that were, you know, they were shovelmen, you know, after the Second World War. There weren't the men around to actually, you know, so they bang all the boys down at 16 years of age to actually shovel the dirt, you know, Phil McGowan and Normie McGowan and all those boys, even Bob Ledger, they all would have been shovelmen from the front.
He passed away, Bob Ledger.
He did, A great loss to the industry. Hey. He was the nicest man in the world, but he was the industry. And it's quite sad that say the things, because where they were, because we used to have, talking about the mines department and all that kind of stuff, and it's a real sore point with me, and I hope it actually gets out there, is that we used to have a works inspector. Now, a works inspector was like, you have the mines inspector, but the mines inspector used to travel with the works inspector. And the works inspector was about the men. You know, they would ask you, you know, like, you didn't work in dusty environments, or, you know, how this mob treating you are, or, and all that kind of stuff. And secretly, the bastards have done away with our works inspector. Who represents the men? Well, these guys that, you know, have been killed in the industry, well, these days, who actually represents them? You know, you're banking on a representative from the company to say, this is what happens. There's no individual, you know, no outsider to say, well, these are the true facts of the day and the event. You know, these days it's put back onto the truth and honesty of the company that you're working for. You know, like,
well, it's different now because a lot of it was unionized when you were working.
No, there was never a union in my time. So Western Mining, Mount Isa Mines and KMA KLV, when I was doing my apprenticeship, sure, had unions, but underground was still underground. It wasn't, you know, like, it was a 5-day-a-week, 6-day-a-week thing working 8-hour days. So everyone was pretty happy. Yep. The miners were always looked after. But you always still had representatives to say, well, this is what's going on. This is what we can do better. You know, like, just, you know, basically someone to come in and say, well, actually, how are you guys going? Or, you know, all those regs that we have in place, you know, are these, you know, are the company you're working for? Because it's a bit, like, we get looked after where we are. And it's a great company to work for, Burncup. But I always worry.
Not everywhere's like that.
Not everywhere's like that. And who actually represents the workers? So if anything was to come out of this, Matt, my one of you, I'd like to ask the West Australian government or the Australian government, where are the works inspector for underground miners?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I think the safety rep takes that brilliant, but they're not
independent. They're still government by your company.
Yeah, they're not independent.
Yeah, and don't worry, they can still be pushed and shoved to any corner they want to be when you're working for a, you know, when you're working for a company. Mm. Like, I've lost a lot of mates down there over the years, you know, like, you've got my first one, Kenny Buller, and then, you know, Paul Fife and Fee and, you know, Scotty Johnson and all that kind of stuff. And I hope that they, you know, like, God bless them all. They're brilliant people. I knew every single one of them, you know, personally. Like, me and Paul Fife used to push our go-karts around Birch Street Boulder at Brennan's when his old man had the sports shops there. Fiona, what a champion girl. I hope they were represented, or, you know, the actual truth of the whole story was actually put out there. Not that you would get anything past Paul or anything, you know, but, like, this, just this day and age with companies the way they are, you know, we're not being represented well enough, I believe.
Mm. Yep.
Yeah. But anyway.
We'll leave that there. You never know. We'll see what comes out of that.
No, but it is a question, you know.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, that's been bloody. Have you got any other stories you want to get off before this is the last?
No, not really.
Probably not driving up every another weekend.
Oh, shit, no. never do it again, man. No, just to all the peers that, you know, all the good men, you know, because you're only ever as good as the men you work, you know, are alongside, Matt, eh? And to all the good men that I've worked with over the years, just thank you. You know, it's like, it's been, mining has just been an incredible adventure and journey, you know, like, I've loved every day of it, you know, like, I don't like it as much these days, but in my day, so I loved it, you know, I just loved going to work. It was good fun. Yeah. And it's got me to where I am. So this beautiful home, bloody everything I have is through, you know, mining. It's been awesome.
Oh, you'd be loaded if you bloody didn't spend it on those fast, bloody penthouse girls and shit.
Fast women, slow horses.
thank you very much for having me, mate. It's been a bloody absolute honour.
No, it's good. It's nice to be able to have a say. And I hope it's all understandable. Usually I speak before thinking.
A couple of bits I might just trim out, but bloody
no. That's
right, we can bloody relax now. We'll get on.
Too easy, mate. I'll go get you a beer.
Yeah, cheers, brother.
Too cool.